high ice water contents are conditions found in large convective storms. It could even be hurricanes, tropical storms, as we're flying in here in this location. Highway conditions have high concentrations of ice crystals. The process by which these large volumes of ice crystals are formed is that you develop an updraft in a warm, moist region. This air rises, and as it rises to higher altitude, it expands because the density and pressure become smaller. This causes the temperatures to become below freezing, so then the vapor condenses out, it forms into ice crystals. The top parts of these large convective complex can expand over hundreds of square miles, and so they're something that's not easily avoided, and aircraft daily fly through these type of scenarios. What we don't know is what is the concentration of ice crystals that may occur in these clouds. They're not easily detected by radar because of their small size. This leads to aircraft sometimes flying into these ice crystals because they don't sense that there is a threat from using their radar. These high density or volume of ice crystals then can result in the engines losing power, and also they can result in certain sensors on the airplane not functioning properly. One of the things that we want to do is to utilize radars, existing radars that are on board the aircraft, and develop algorithms which will be able to detect these high levels of ice crystals that might be dangerous and allow us to navigate through thunderstorm ambles or cloud masses that are produced from the large convective systems.
Pilots are commenting it's pretty heavy.
Lyle, what did we get for a peak there?
Just at around 2 grams.
What we are doing here with our in situ measurements is trying to relate the ice water content levels to what the radar signatures are being recorded by Steve's systems.
Here we are collecting weather radar data and in situ probes, correlating the two along our flight path. The radar that we're using today is a commercial weather radar. In front of me, you can see four different displays, various different tilts of the radar antenna, one that's significantly above our flight level, one at our flight level, one below our flight level, and then one significantly below our flight level. With that volume of space that we're covering, we're hoping to be able to detect signatures, things that are like a thumbprint or a fingerprint of this atmospheric condition.
We have four instruments. We have an isokinetic evaporator probe. What it does is the ice crystals are going inside the isokinetic probe where all of that ice crystal is evaporated. We're measuring the water vapor and evaporating through those particles to get the total condensate water vapor. We have three other probes on the wingtips. They measure the ice particle sizes. This screen over here is one of the particle probes that we have on board the airplane. We're getting a representation of the particles that we're flying through. What we see right here in this particular display is the satellite IR depiction with the flight track. What we're trying to do is find regions of high ice water content that's typically found in the cold cloud top area, which is depicted by the white and purple areas. We are working with the information from the ground, from the satellite information, to pick out waypoints. We pass that information to the mission manager, who provides it to the navigator, who provides it to the pilots.
Yargo, NASA 817, we have one other point we'd like to work. It's 1500 north, 5500 west.
We're we're monitoring and making sure that we are getting into the kinds of conditions that we are wanting to get into.
You can see we're currently flying in the weather, looking for the icing, and you can see, can't see anything out the front, so we're primarily relying on our instruments to know where we're going and make sure we're going where we need to go and collecting the data that we need.
Ice water went to near zero and is now trending back up.
So Steve, in that last run when we reached about 2, radar, was it still green?
Yeah, no, I think it was even black.
This is a pretty interesting section here, just like Steve predicted.
Tim, I think you've got a pitot disagree.
Because we have a pitot issue right now.
We lost both airspeeds.
This HIWC mission is a little bit different than most of our science missions. You know, our concern that we're flying our four engines into engine icing conditions. We are also concerned about our pitostatic and our total air temperature probes that they could ice up during the mission. With both pitots failed, we could continue for about 10 more minutes in the failed anomalous situation. But we're looking for a way to get out of the icing condition. Typically, it's just flying out of the clouds and things will clear up. The other way is to actually descend. They're coming back. Looks like they're back.
Science, our pitots are back.
Steve, will you be good for east-west runs?
I should be.
Maybe we can get a recommendation from the ground on what those might be.
It's like we're starting to get the decline in nice water. We're down about 6/10 now, half a gram, 6/10.
Okay. Yes. Nice profile, though, eh? Gee.
It's good data.
This has been different. We had our anomalies with some of like the air data computers, which loses the airspeed indication for the pilots. We had those happen because of all the icing and stuff that was getting on the pitot probes. Kind of got everybody on edge, and everybody is just kind of making sure we're staying within our correct airspeed and we're not, something else is not being affected at the same time.
We're flying in the soup, as pilots would call it, because we're clouds all around. The aircraft itself is getting exposed to a lot of moisture and cold air. We start coming out of it to return to base, and it thaws out. We have to check the radome occasionally, especially after flying for a while in there, because those small particles can start eroding away the coating, and the moisture inside the radome will make the radar ineffective.
What we were able to accomplish during this 3-week campaign, we had 10 flights, and we were able to gather the radar data and the in situ measurements for highest water content data. It was complete success. We went way beyond my expectations. So thank you, DC-8.